Hey again, it's Jason from Fraser Valley Rose Farm. Well, it may not be a surprise to you, I'm a bit of a garden geek. I watch a lot of videos on YouTube about gardening, and it seems like I may have seen maybe a dozen times videos on how to use eggshells in your garden. And usually they have a thumbnail that goes something like this. You won't believe what happens in your garden when you add eggshells. And here's the spoiler. You actually will believe it, because almost nothing will happen. Certainly not very quickly, and even the long-term effects are a bit debatable. I like to look at the issue of adding eggshells or pulverized eggshells into your garden as a bit of a placebo. It's like a doctor prescribing a sugar pill to somebody to help them feel better about a problem which they may or may not have. It does very little towards addressing a calcium problem in your plants. And so I want to talk, let's look at eggshells as a red herring here. They're fine. They're fine to throw into your compost. They're just like banana peels, just like coffee grounds, anything that you want to throw into your compost to make a good compost, go ahead. But they're not a solution to calcium deficiencies directly in plants. And if you're going to try to use them that way, you have to answer three questions right away. Number one, do you have symptoms of calcium deficiency in your plant? Second of all, how do you verify that you do actually have a soil calcium deficiency? And third, would eggshells be the solution to that anyway? So I'm going to go through that in this video. Hang tight. Okay, sorry. It starts to rain outside there, so I don't want to mess up the camera, so I had to tuck underneath some cover here. But let's talk about those symptoms of calcium deficiency. So in a tomato, it's fairly easy to spot. So if you've got a tomatoes or peppers and you see blossom end rot, what that is like a black ring that develops on the end of the fruit where the blossom used to be. And of course, it rots the fruit. That's a sure sign that calcium was missing at some point when the fruit was beginning to develop. So the question is, does that mean that you have deficient calcium in your soil? And the short answer to that is no. More often, blossom end rot is related to the uptake of calcium and not so much available calcium in the soil. So for instance, if you have irregular watering, like let's say you got a lot of rain and then a dry patch, at some point during that period, your tomato plant will have trouble bringing up calcium just from a moisture management point of view. And it only takes a short time for a fruit to develop that blossom end rot. So even if the calcium is missing for a short period of time, that'll do it. Also in high humidity situations. So if you're growing stuff indoors and you've got extra high humidity for a long period of time, your plants may develop problems uptaking that nutrient. So it is not always an issue that your soil is missing the calcium. In fact, that's the least common version of calcium deficiency. So let's say you do, and let's just talk about other plants. Like if you're looking at leafy greens, like broccoli or brassicas or lettuce, and you're looking at the symptoms of calcium deficiency, usually it presents as one of the younger leaves or some of the younger leaves having problems enlarging early on. You'll see some chlorosis there, and eventually, if it's bad enough, you'll see that the tip will abort on the plant. Now, the problem is that that can also be signs of other nutrient deficiencies, so it can mask itself. So just trying to eyeball it based on what's happening on your plant can be a hard way to figure out if you need to add calcium to your soil. The second question is, okay, how do you know? Like, how do you know if your soil has enough calcium? And do I recommend you run out and grab a soil test? And I'm a little skeptical on that. You know, first of all, soil tests have a mixed track record of figuring out whether available calcium is a problem in your soil. What they can tell you, and what I would suggest you look at if you do get a soil test, is your soil pH. So here's some general rules of thumb. If you have a coarse or sandy soil, rather than a heavy or dense or clayey soil, the coarse and sandy soil usually will have more problems with calcium than the dense or clayey soil. It has to do with cation exchange capacity. And so, in general, you're more likely to have a problem with a loose or sandy soil. Also, as relates to pH, you are much more likely to have a calcium problem with a low pH rather than a neutral or a high pH. So if you get that soil test back and it shows that you have a low pH, then that's something that you can dig into. That's something you can look at and say, well, let's be honest about all the nutrients here, is that most nutrients have better availability to the plants near a neutral pH. So somewhere around 6.5 through 7, most of the nutrients have a band of high absorption through your plants. So if you found that you had low pH, adjusting it would be a good thing. And most of the time you adjust it with lime or high calcium amendments. So that's what I can say about a soil test. You know, it's more useful to find out if your pH is low, and then you can do the diagnostic in your head about, okay, do I have a coarse or sandy soil? And if both of those conditions persist, and you want to adjust the pH upwards, that's probably a pretty decent gardening measure. So the third question is, are eggshells the solution to this? They certainly won't hurt if they're as a part of a balanced compost, it's not a problem. But the fact is that eggshells are just too small in terms of their weight, in terms of how much they would add to your garden to make much of a difference. So if you're dealing with a garden patch, you're much, much better to go with a bulk amendment than with eggshells. And let me show you something here. These are oyster shells. I picked this up at my local feed store for about $15. It's 50 pounds. I'll show you the inside of the bag as well. It has just about precisely the same analysis as eggshells. It even looks the same as eggshells. And if you were planning on using this as a way to deter slugs or snails, and eggshells are hard to get a big enough volume to do that, then oyster shells are a good way to look at that too. But the difference is that this bag contains the equivalent of almost 4,000 eggs. So that's about the amount that an average American would eat in 15 years. So do you want to spend 15 years? Maybe you have a family, maybe it's only 7 years, or 4 years correcting it. But if you want to correct your soil pH and therefore correct a calcium problem, you probably want to act a little quicker than that. So do you want to wait a long time and collect a bunch of eggshells and put them in the microwave to sterilize them and then pulverize them to a fine powder, in your blender, and then somebody says, hey, why does my strawberry milkshake feel so chunky? So that's not the best solution. Usually you're better off going with something like oyster shells or just lime. And if, let me go back a step and say, if you've seen calcium deficiency problems in your plant and you're pretty confident that's what it is and you want to try to correct that, fixing your soil calcium is much, much slower than directly applying calcium to your plant. So you can apply things like calcium chloride or calcium nitrate, and those things will quickly address a calcium problem in your plant right now within the season, rather than waiting the time that it takes for this stuff to start to change the soil chemistry. So I hope this answers some of your questions on eggshells and calcium particularly. If you have any questions about that, comments, I'm expecting some comments on this one, please drop those below the video, and we'll see what kind of discussion we can have about it. Thank you so much for watching.